Welcome to Space News from the Electric Universe, brought to you by the Thunderbolts Project at thunderbolts.info. In the conclusion of this three-part presentation, Andrew Hall continues his meticulous analysis of compelling evidence for electrical scarring throughout the American Southwest. In parts one and two, Hall explored the complex electrical discharge process called sputtering discharge, and how this process might have shaped the breathtaking features on the Colorado Plateau. As we've also documented on this series, it is well known that powerful electric fields can produce ionic winds, which can rapidly create erosional features. Did such powerful winds once accompany cosmic lightning bolts that struck the Earth, indelibly shaping our planet's surface?
In part one of Sputtering Canyons, we discussed Arches National Monument and evidence it was formed by complex sputtering discharge process. That process involved thermal spiking, barrier discharge, and a layer of wet sandstone. In part two, we looked at Monument Valley and how charge and charge depletion disperses through rock by the combined mechanisms of current drift and diffusion. We looked at evidence of diffusion patterns in the landscape and evidence of mechanical shear caused by sputtering discharge. In part three, we'll look at some secondary effects from electrical deposition and sputtering on the Colorado Plateau. These features involve processes besides sputtering discharge and lightning bolts. These features also involve the winds of the storm. In the primordial plasma typhoon that layered the dome of the Colorado Plateau, winds were mobilized by the Earth's electric field. Ionic species of opposite charge were pushed in opposite directions. Positive and negative species segregated into streams of unipolar winds that circled the Earth in bands, moving in alternate directions. The electric field gradient was from pole to pole, or at least where the poles are now. So the wind circled north to south and south to north. The effect was the same as the counter-rotating bands of wind on Jupiter. Where they met was the anodic hotspot where supervolcanoes belched ash and flame, and the bowels of the Earth spilled forth molten rock. Between the supervolcanic maw of Yellowstone and the stratovolcanic cones on the Mogollon Rim sits the Colorado Plateau, where these winds mixed in a plasma cyclone. The meeting on the unipolar winds was the Earth-sized equivalent of the Great Red Spot on Jupiter. A sustained and violent storm charged with electricity and bent by magnetic fields, a storm beyond any biblical description. Like Jupiter, the wind screamed at several hundred miles per hour. Mach effects, like standing shock waves and supersonic shear, created extreme pressure, density, and temperature differentials. Vast updrafts and downdrafts developed. Tornadoes spun up to 50 and 100 miles across, all of it carrying electric current. Where shock waves form, electric current flows. This is a known phenomenon. The whole idea of an EMP weapon, an electromagnetic pulse that can knock out transformers and electronic systems, destroying the grid and communications, is based on this fact. Explode a nuclear bomb in the atmosphere, and it will send out a shock wave. The shock wave carries the electromagnetic pulse that spikes current suddenly and wipes out electronics and power grids. There is no battery in the nuclear bomb that creates the EMP. The EMP forms naturally in the shock wave. There are several effects that cause this. First, the shock wave is a sharp discontinuity in density. And where density is higher, of course, there is more matter, so a higher concentration of ambient ions collect there, naturally raising charge density in the shock wave. The temperature is higher too, so that causes ionization in the shock wave. And there is higher pressure, so particle collisions are more frequent, again ionizing the shock wave. And most important of all, the bomb itself sends radiation with the shock wave. So all these effects add up to a large electric current in the shock wave, and it is self-amplifying. As ionization frees electrons to roam, they knock away more electrons in a runaway chain reaction driven by the kinetic energy in the shock wave. process is related to the diffusion of charge discussed in part two. But in this case, the current diffusion is contained by the shock wave. The shock wave and electric pulse are coherent with each other. Any place a supersonic wind hits an object, or is forced to change vector, or where it shears against winds moving at a different velocity, a shock wave forms. A projection, like a mountain, would create a standing shock wave that creased the wind and generated current. In a plasma atmosphere, that current would grow very large. Another feature of shock waves is they reflect. Like any wave, a light wave, an ocean wave, when it hits something, some of its energy echoes. When it does, it echoes in harmonic relationship to the wave that made it. Shock waves can reflect off of each other or align with each other and vibrate in harmonic resonance. Every lightning bolt, every belch from a volcanic vent, sent new shock waves to reverberate through the air and echo from whatever they hit. Every sheet of current in them altered the electric field around it, and the atmosphere vibrated with charged waves, stiffened and resonating with feedback from the energy of the storm itself. Some traveled at the speed of sound, while standing waves, reflected from stationary objects exposed to the wind, stayed in one place. They crossed, interfered, and canceled each other. In the chaotic turbulence of the supersonic electric storm, shock waves literally patterned the atmosphere. Because the shock waves carry current and magnetic fields result, the right-hand rule forces waves into a cross-flow pattern with 90-degree angles. Consider how ocean waves can form a coherent pattern in a cross-current sea, as shown in this photo from Ile de Ré Lighthouse off the coast of France. Shock waves formed a similar effect, only carrying electric current. As the layers of the dome built the Colorado Plateau, they scarred the land with these patterns. This shockwave fracture pattern is almost universally found in the rim rock and cap rock of sputtered canyon walls, buttes, and pinnacles. The fracturing takes the form of parallel joints or checkerboard blocks. The blocks are sometimes deeply cut and they look like broken teeth. Other cases, they are straight, evenly spaced, parallel fissures. Razor-thin shock waves created the fractures in the cap and rim rock as the dome was deposited, while it was still hot in plastic. Thermal contraction during cooling and the tearing away of material during sputtering broke the rocks along the shock-induced fracture lines. The same effect is seen in completely different geologic formations. The wind-blown buttresses on mountain flanks. These images are from Combe Ridge, which is the southern rim of the Monument Valley Dome, and San Rafael Reef, which is the southern rim of the San Rafael Swell. Both are dunes of triangular buttresses formed by the supersonic wind sucked into the storm that formed the domes. The shock waves from the supersonic winds that formed the dunes impressed themselves into the rocks. The shockwave currents shatter into harmonic reflections in ever smaller patterns. In formations where extremely high energy was available, such as the hardened plates of flat iron buttresses on the San Rafael Reef, the shockwaves continued to shatter, reflect, and reverberate down to the smallest scale. This rock photographed from a flat iron buttress in Utah by Robert Hawthorne during a field trip following the 2017 conference shows parallel cuts in rock only a half inch apart. This rock, photographed by the author from another buttress in Utah during the 2016 field trip, it shows the squiggled fractures of a dissipating shock-induced current along the back edge of the buttress. These rills only penetrate a fraction of an inch into the rock and really defy any other explanation unless rock-eating worms cut these paths. Another feature related to shock-induced currents is linear, parallel formations are something we'll call inverse dikes. A dike is a vertical wall of rock. It can be freestanding or it can be embedded in apparent rock, like a quartz vein in granite. Quartz veins are caused by very high current shock waves. These dikes are made of minette, which is very high in potassium ratio, making the rock highly alkaline, or anionic, which means its electrons were sucked out. They were made by shockwave currents, electrosonic waves that scored across the land and fused the parent sands into walls of electrochemically altered rock. These emanate from Comb Ridge on the south side of Monument Valley, and they are coherent with the triangular flat iron buttresses of the cone, which were formed by the same shock waves. Inverse dikes are similar wall-like features that were formed by currents that depleted the rock, shielding it from sputter. These upended pancake walls at Arches National Monument, Utah, were left standing as the lanes between them were sputtered away, in the same fashion that preferential sputtering left mesas and pinnacles in the shadow of lightning strikes. Only for these, the diffusion of charge depletion was shaped by the electrosonic shock waves. You can see they are layered, like the deposition layers of the mesas themselves. Dikes don't have deposition layers. They actually cut through deposition layers. These are not dikes, they're inverse dikes, and they do have deposition layers because they were part of the dome before it sputtered away. Another phenomenon related to the whole sputtering process is gaseous explosions. It primarily occurs during dome deposition when hot sand rains down, accelerated by the electric field on the eye wall of the storm, to be pressed into a layer on the dome. After deposition, but while the rock is still hot and plastic, still popping and sizzling with excess charge, volatile mixtures accumulate in pockets. The pockets migrate through weak joints, the dikes and veins in the rock, to explode near the surface, leaving holes from bubble bursts. Now remember, the veins and joints are current-carrying, shock-induced features, so they dissipate heat and current as they cool. It's very similar to the heat-spiking bubbles that created Arches National Monument, but this occurs during dome deposition, not during sputter. The gases are aided or caused by residual current in the rock escaping after it deposited. It can leave perfect bubble imprints in dense, hardened rock. Look carefully at the bubble imprint lower left of the arch. In this picture, it has a Y-shaped ridge that is the precise symmetric pattern molded into the rock that a three bubbles connected would present, because they have to equalize pressure across their membrane. This is not water erosion. This is bubble explosion. They also explode outward in large jets, off-gassing hot, fresh mountain as it settled and cooled, leaving yawning throats like this one. The light at another time of day on this same yawning throat in the San Rafael Reef, Utah, shows the band of white crystalline dike that the gas has migrated through. The tonsils in this throat are a blade of the rock dike. And this slot canyon, also in the San Rafael Reef, was cut by a discharge of current and off-gassing. The discharge here was powerful enough to cut the narrow canyon, implying it was an arc mode discharge. The throat of the discharge is a hole in the back of the canyon about 3 feet in diameter. It's choked with an effluvia that followed the discharge and solidified as it dripped from the throat. There's a vertical dike in the rock aligned with the hole, which can be seen as a white streak in the V-notch above the hole in this image. The throat is completely choked with the effluvia. The effluvia is black and textured, much like minette, which is found in lightning-generated features elsewhere in this region. A runnel of the black effluvia drips from the throat, and the walls near the throat are splattered with a white substance. Taste testing the white substance indicated an alkaline and bitterness. Being in a national park, though, we could not take samples. Off-gassing bubbles can be quite elaborate in volatile flows of foaming minerals. Here's a carbonate rock that fizzed like seltzer before it suddenly phase changed to solid, leaving exquisite bubble molds. Such sudden phase change implies an instantaneous electrochemical process due to electrical discharge and recombination. This rock didn't just cool off and form these bubble molds. It instantly solidified due to electrochemical processes. This image shows why off-gassing bubbles are part of deposition, not sputtering. The bubbles are in the untouched surface rock above, while the scallop break in the rock, which was caused by sputtering, has no holes. Therefore, the holes were already there when the canyon was sputtered, and are only a near-surface feature caused by the off-gassing. While theory and conclusions presented here are the sole opinion of the author, appreciation of the researchers who spent hot Grammy hours exploring canyon lands to obtain these photos and data is due. Researchers Larry White, Bruce Laybourne, David Orr, and Steve Cash, and my dog Ginger endured extreme heat, dangerous roads, treacherous heights, and fine sand in their food, examining the wonders of canyonlands, Utah, for this article. To them, thank you very much.